Okay, so we're going to work on the watercolor tutorial with this elk. I'm not doing this live because we tried that once and it really did not work out for me. Alright, so I need to stop moving this. I apologize. So first I want to get my kneaded eraser and lighten up our guidelines here. Guidelines at this point are not important anymore because we're going to go right to work on it. And then we're going to go in with three pencils. These are all watercolor pencils. And we have dipped them in water before applying them so they apply a little bit better. Be a little bit more consistent with getting pigment down. Not sure that that's showing up as well as I would like, but here we have our highlights. Alright, and now we're going to go for our midtones. So, first pencil was golden yellow. This one is a quote unquote light brown. I would equivalent it to some sienna. Now I'm using the paper dry and getting the pencil itself wet. Nice bright eye there. Not a lot of detail in that. Not so far at least. Alright, so now we need to get a little low light in there. So now we're going with a little burnt umber. Make sure that that is good and wet. And we're going to set that back just a touch. Like that. Okay. I am going to go in and actually put the pupil on this guy. I apologize, I'm wearing one of my hats to keep the actual studio lights out of my eyes, and unfortunately the brim of my hat keeps hitting the lights. Try doing that. That way I won't be hitting it so much. Alright, so over here there is a pretty big chunk out of the light right there. And in the corner. So, I'm going to use a brush with no pigment on it at all. We're going to kind of drag the accenting down here. Now bear in mind that this eye is really small compared to an actual elk. And right now there is a lot of pigment on it, so as you can see by just adding a little bit of water, it intensifies things a whole lot. And this is a 000. Those of you who are curious. Alright. The sad thing is that this got carried a little bit too far. That right there, so we're gonna just kind of lift that out. So I'm going to get a slightly larger brush like water, and just lift that out. I do want to add a little bit more of our dark brown because that eye is just a little bit too bright. Oop. All right. I'm just gonna carry that there. All right. And now we're into our actual palette of paint. Same color. Now we're going to just pre-wet this area right here. And the reason we're pre-wetting it before we paint is that what's going to happen is that it's going to get really, really runny and the paint's going to want to run. And to some degree, I'm okay with that. But it's also going to want to buckle as it absorbs all this water. And I'm okay with that too, as long as it's controlled. And this is merely a single zero brush, bearing in mind that there is a lot of detail that we're just gonna be not focusing on right now. We're not focusing on the detail, we're focusing on the color. Just give that a couple of minutes to soak in. Now we're going to sit with the more natural colors rather than the bright colors. And this guy's got a little bit of a yellow patch in here. And this is some just pulled a blank on what color this is. I realize there's a lot of glare in there, so let me see if I can't change the lights so we're not quite so glary. There we go. And I have more room for my face to see stuff. Awesome. Alright. So then I'm going to carry some of that burnt umber down. And we're going to just let it run just a touch. Just a touch. You don't need a hard edge. Thank you. And this burnt umber is a little bit too cold. Not necessarily real like it. So I'm going to give it a little bit of warmth. Yellow ochre, I apologize, I just remembered that. That yellow is yellow ochre. Alright, so let's see if we can't go in with our eraser here and get rid of this pencil line right here. Don't necessarily want this thing based on lines that I draw there. Some really strong color right now. I'm just going to kind of dilute it just a little bit. And since we really do have an awful lot on here, we're just going to use it kind of to dilute everything, bring that color down. All right, we'll get back this out just a touch. So now we're going to just use the burnt umber and the raw sienna. I'm going to pull the crow color down into the neck. Some more of that yellow ochre. I'm just going to thin that out a little bit. Okay. And as we get into the bottom part of his chest where his ruff is, I need to get back into some of that burnt umber. But, just as importantly, get rid of this deviation line. We need to make sure that we're getting into a little bit of ultramarine blue so we can show the definition of the reflections. As I said, this tutorial is going to go real quick because I'm really looking for a color balance and the colors that jump out at me, so I remember to carry them into the next segment, which is going to be acrylics. So a little bit of that really dark stuff here. I don't want just a little bit of ultramarine blue mixed in. I'm just gonna, for a brown, that's pretty cool. Hey man, that's really good. It's a cool color. It's not very, very blue. I'm just gonna double down on that blue. This is gonna add to our shadows and give him some real definite depth here. Oh man, like you just totally it just I did. Alright, let me get rid of that right there. And now I'm just going to go in really with just a lot of that blue, because that's what's really prominent, is that blue. Hope there's not too much glare. It's really hard at this. I want to back out to see whether or not there's a lot of glare or not. A little bit more ultramarine blue. And just coat a few strokes over here. Done with these pencils, so we can get out of that. Alright, but I seem to have a little bit of creeping going on up here, so we're going to get back into that burnt umber raw sienna mix. And we're just going to reinforce the color I need coming down here, because this guy's going to need a lot of deep. We need to push all these darker tones with this big guy because we don't want him to lose that very weighted emphasis that he has. His muzzle is still real dark right through here. And some highlights. Real dark thatchy patch here. Can we carry that through here? Just lift this all over here and just move it slightly to the left. Few highlights coming in here, so we're going to go back into that yellow, a little yellow ochre. We're just going to go back in here with that yellow ochre. Start creeping up on some of these lines. I'm going to get rid of them so that they are not very prominent. I really don't want these to be the be-all and end-all of these lines. Looks like I got a little bit of glare going on there. That just made it worse. And alright, hopefully that's a little bit better for you. So, let's carry this down into the muzzle, right up to the nose. There we go. As I'm lifting this off, I'm wiping the excess on a towel. Alright. A little bit of this that's going on over here. Now, up on this guy's head, there is a rough patch of fur. And you notice this spot right here? Let's see if we can get in that. And get a nice tight shot. See that right there? That is because I didn't erase that line before I got to the part where I painted over it, so it's going to be really hard to get rid of it now because the tooth of paper that's been now pulled up, and it really will not want to let go of it. So we're going to get some dark shadow here and here. Just kind of push the antler back, and we're doing it by mixing that raw sienna and the raw sienna and the ultramarine blue. But this guy's got like some really bright looking funky fur on the top of his head. And we were able to kind of depict that fur with our charcoal by giving it light shadow. But here we're gonna give it color. So it's a really nice kind of chestnut color, and it's got some really pretty yellow highlights. And unfortunately, this piece is so small that getting those yellow highlights in there is going to be kind of a buggering trick. So what we're going to do is have to fill in a little bit like that, and then kind of compensate with some blue. Alright, now you'll notice that I'm kind of getting a line going down here, and I bet you're wondering why. And if you're not wondering why, it's probably because you have watched the charcoal tutorial and know the anatomy of this elk pretty well. Now the reason is because this guy's got a line of fur down here. You need to kind of get a shadow going where that fur kind of done breaks up the mass of his face. And we can also go in here and kind of note that there's a shadow here. And that we've got some fur that goes this way. And again, we're still trying to follow that rule of keeping your strokes in the direction of whatever it is that you're painting, fur-wise. So if the fur goes this way, we're going to keep it this way. If it goes this way, we're going to change direction. Alright, now right about here, I'm going to get in some zoom here. Right about here, there's still the line from its mouth. Now, normally I might erase that line, but it's going to be a dark black line anyway, so I'm going to leave it there just as a guideline. This line, however, I'm going to get rid of because there's actually a highlight there on the fur, and I think I was a little too late in getting this. Might not be able to get all of it out. Most of it's out. Okay. So there is a dark area right there, but there is a highlight with the yellow ochre. Alright, so this right here kind of looks like crap. I'm not going to lie about that. That looks like kind of crap. But now we're going to make it look much better. So we've kind of got all these grades in here. Now we're going to get all the smaller strokes to go away. And I'm literally just going over this with some water. Just going to blend all these smaller strokes away. Okay, so we gave this guy a couple minutes to dry, and so now we're going to go in with some more detailing layers. So, back in with that 3-0, and back in with the burnt umber and the ultramarine blue. So I'm not really going for I'm not really going for things like black. I really want to kind of emphasize the fact that we're starting to get some detail in here. And it is a little warped, so I apologize, but okay, so in with this right here. And again, it's a very fine brush, so okay. And then we're gonna make this eye look a lot less crazy. Haven't changed colors at all. So we're kind of using this instead of the using blue or black. Okay. Anchor this antler here. Right, now I'm going to add a little bit of my raw sienna. Birds in the raw sienna. Yep, we're just going to start picking out part of his coat here. And we're gonna set that eye back a little bit more. One of the reasons why this eye looks so crazy is because it looks bug-eyed. It looks bug-eyed because it's not set back. We still have a lot of, lack of a better term, bug-eyeness. Bug-eyes! Rudolph the bug-eyed elk. Yep. Alright, so I've got a little too dark this time. So I'm just gonna lift that up a little bit. And I'll just go and we'll straight in with the sienna, which again is a little bit much, but we'll just let that out slowly. And magically, he doesn't look quite so crazy anymore. Alright, so let's go back to that antler right here. Okay. And we need some of that sienna. And if for some reason you were watching the live version of this tutorial and things seem a little bit more fluid, it's A, that I wasn't so angry, and B, I actually took time out to get the good paints out and not the crappy, like dollar paints, because it's very infuriating to try and do a tutorial when you can't even say what paint you're using. Kind of leave that like that. Then we're back in with the umber and the ultramarine blue again. And again, this is why learning to not rely on black is really important, because now you're kind of understanding how you're color mixing, which is that tutorial on color theory and complementary colors, how this all comes into play. That would be a wonderful challenge for my acrylic artist friends. Step away from the black. Step back and do a little bit of watercolor where you're not going to want to do black, because it'll just dull down your painting. Alright, so then we got a little bit of this color, same color. It comes over here and helps kind of make this eye stand out. I'm not going to use it in a lot. I do want to bring back some of that burnt umber. And there's a lot of texture in that, and really, seriously, I wasn't kidding when I said this is less about texture and more about color. So we're going to soften that up just by adding some water to it. Okay. Farther back toward this antler I go, closer into that eye I'm going to go, and the warmer I'm going to go. So we're going to go back into our precipice of sienna and yellow. There we go. And give this guy a real good anchor. And the nice thing about doing, another nice thing about doing watercolor versus acrylic, or keep in mind you can get acrylics to work like watercolors. It's just a matter of thinning them down so they're not very viscous. And then continuing to dilute them throughout the painting process. And what I was going to say is that it forces you to be aware of your lights and your darks, and your light sources, and how natural light affects the color that you're painting with. So, yep, it's true. An animal that you know is going to be brown may actually look blue. That to the one. And just softening up those edges. Now, I got some crazy, pretty crazy stuff up there, but I promise you we're going to take care of that. So now we're going to mix the sienna with the umber. Keep in mind that translate to all of your shadow colors. So anywhere that there's a shadow, we're going to use a little bit of umber on there to get it to translate real well. I'm looking at that mix and I think we're going to go a little bit of umber. So a little bit of umber sienna and then ultramarine. There we go. That's a better color. All right. A little bit more. Yeah. And you know what? I'm gonna have to dilute it to the our yellow, so you don't want to lose the highlights here. My goodness, there's a lot of glare up here. That's one of the reasons why I'm not real fond of using this camera, is because it's not really translating very well. Alright, so I'm still going off my reference picture and finding my highlights and general lowlights and my shadows. Now if you get like I did there, where you get a little bit too much dark in one spot, you can always go through with straight water. Use the water to soften your edge and then lift out your top layer. Kind of like that. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to let this dry for a few minutes and then I'm going to come back to it because I've got a little bit of blotchiness going over here and it's not really mixing the way I'd like it to, and I don't want to lose anybody in the next segment where we get into getting some of this to come together. So pull this down into this upper mandible. And I will be back. Alright, so here we are. And so here's a couple of problems here, is that there's a highlight and all of his little head bobbing thing going on here. And I know that actually has a term, I just can't remember it right now. So we're going to need to go back in with that raw sienna and the hook and the hooker's green. Wow, sorry. Yellow ochre. And just give me some highlights here. Just like that. And then we're going to need to carry that down into here, otherwise it's just going to look like we just blopped something there. And the best way we're going to do that is, remember earlier where I said that we're going to need to get this a little warmer? We're going to carry that over there. That's where it's going to go. We can kind of muddle this right here now. Pick up some color and just move it over here. Got another light patch here, so we're just going to lift some of this out here. Okay, and not too far down, because get too light, you kind of lose the illusion we got going on here. So we're back in just with some pure blue, because the coat's reflecting the blue of the sky around it, so we're just going to go in with a little bit of blue and bring that back. Carry that blue down underneath the eye, and you mix it with the browns. Don't forget, it's going to translate as your shadow color. Okay, we got an awful lot of just dead space here where it's just monochromatic from it drying and settling. So we're going to go in and just put in a couple of strokes and see if we can't get that to change. Some of that happens when it's when the paper's super saturated and it's humped, which is where it kind of distorts. So we're going to go through and just kind of work with it a little bit. Watercolor is very, very forgiving when you screw up with it. So if you start to go the wrong direction, don't get all upset and melodramatic. Chances are you can fix it. It's kind of like there's this line that kind of formed here, and I'm not real fond of that line, so we're just going to kind of lift some of that out. I still want the blue that goes down the front of the face. Just don't necessarily want the... All right. So that is really horribly translated on the camera. So you could do this. There we go. So then we took that kind of monochromatic look, lift it out, lifted it out a little bit over here. Gave a line right here. Alright, now we do have a lot of blue that we need to add in over here. So we're going to go in a little bit with that ultramarine blue and then a little thylacine blue. And the thylacine blue was just a little bit warmer. And it'll go better with any addition of that sienna, which translates into a shadow. So here we go, we need to come this needs to come down here. Just like that. Alright. And then this all becomes like a shadow. And there's a highlight in that shadow. And then this over here doesn't stay blue. So there is a line here, but it's not accentuated by blue. It's accentuated by the sienna. Going back in here. And in here. So the other thing we have is we have a pattern change as we're gonna bring out some of this fur that kind of goes down our nose, his nose. It's the most stellar female I've ever seen. Alright. And we're gonna make her his head. I don't know why I keep calling it a girl. Not before anybody gets all upset and says, oh no, no, she just grabbed red or black. I didn't grab black. I mixed the Prussian blue with the burnt sienna. So we're gonna do that. So you take the burnt sienna. And this blue. You're going to get black. See? But I'm not using a new color that we haven't already used in this painting, and that's really, really important, because if you use a whole new color, like if I were to suddenly go in here with a color that is completely unrelated to anything else in this painting, it's going to stick out and look unbalanced. But I can also go in with this color now and access some other things. Okay, so case in point, go underneath this jaw. Because this is happening. Okay, so we clearly have a deer-like creature, although accuracy. Now we're going in with the umber, the sienna, and a little bit of that yellow. So I don't necessarily need a lighter color, but I do need a warmer color. We also need to emphasize how this dark banding here also goes down into the throat right here. And it comes down and it kind of hooks down here somewhere. Okay, so now I did that with the mix of the umber and the other blue, the one that becomes black. Now, if I take and I go back to the ultramarine blue and the umber, you're going to get a slightly different result because of the colors around it. So this becomes where, if you're a woman and you've ever bought black anything, you understand the term of it's blue green, or it's a green green, or it's a red green. It's a green black. It's a red black, or it's a blue black. Because the tones around this blue, or around this black, what we need to be the shadow color, or red, we need to go in with a more red-based shadow than a blue or green-based shadow. So if we go in with the wrong color, it's gonna look wrong. Now as I'm kind of fleshing this out, I realize that this is just a little bit too dark right here. We're just gonna lift some of that out. Alright, so right now this is really not too bad. I mean, it could be a finished painting, but it's not really what it's meant to be, so. Going with a more green version of that dark shadow color rather than the warm one. We'll set that ear back. Carry this down the neck. But it's not going to look quite as off here because you have all of these that you're going to have that yellow ochre to offset it. Here we go, we're just gonna run it down the neck, just like this. But now you have a dilemma, because now you have to get into that shoulder, into that roof. So bringing back that raw sienna burnt umber mix. Alright, so now that we've gone into that, we can go back to our mix of the umber and the blue. And this time we're going to mix both blues in with that umber. Just gonna do choppy little strokes here because we're really gonna emphasize that thick part of his coat here. This is becoming a really, really heavy color laden piece. Keep in mind, I haven't touched the black yet, other than putting in the pupil on his eye, which is a real fine point. Okay, so on the ultramarine blue, my phthalo blue. A little bit of an anchor. And now we're in with this. This is a 3. So we jumped from a 1 to a 3. And that's because, well, I wind up getting into these little sorted spots where I wind up with a lot of small details which on a watercolor look bad. Now we're changing up the game just a little bit. And I want this other section to really translate the light really, really well. So we're going to put lots of light colors with it. Have his hand over here, and actually I skipped it again. That's okay. Actually, that's gonna carry down here. Yep, picking up some of that other color. All right, we're gonna get this set to dry, and then we're gonna do another layer. So now, like an idiot, I left that line in there. I'm never going to get rid of it. So it was the yellow ochre and a little of the cadmium yellow. It's actually cad orange. So it's a little cad orange. Some yellow ochre, and now we're going to put in just a little cad yellow light. Alright, this was actually a lot of cad yellow light. It's way more than I wanted. Alright. And a little cad yellow light. Alright, so now we've got, all intents and purposes, a little mane that elk have. something with that. The little caveat orange. And again, never going to get rid of that line because I didn't remove it when I had the chance. Now, here is my watercolor tip and trick. Let's get out all of these fine areas. You lay in a little bit of water. Okay. You wait a couple of minutes, and then you literally lift it out. Know how this is a little too dark right here? We're literally just gonna lift this out so it's not too long. Don't let it sit too long. The longer you let it sit, the more it's gonna lift out, because the more layers of the paper it's gonna have a chance to eat through. Okay. Ta-ta! Not enough punch. Lift some out. Okay. Same thing here. We lifted quite a bit of this out. There's a really, really strong highlight from the sun right there. Q-tip and just lift it right out. Lift, lift, lift. There we go. Alright, so then we're going to do another thing here. And that is, our elk no longer has a highlight in his eye. It makes me sad. Here we go. That is a really quick highlight right there. Okay. Gonna lift some more of that out. Okay, so just in case you can't see that. Just in case you're thinking, well, it really still doesn't look quite right. And I have to agree. Go in with that umber and that blue, because there should be a shadow right here. Now that, I think we can all agree, looks pretty bad. Again, we're not leaving it like that. Alright, so we just got that little eyeliner that he's supposed to have now. And then we're just going to go through lower than that and then drip in that white. There we go. Much better. Alright, now, as I kind of pick apart this eye, I really don't like how incredibly overemphasized the line is here, because it shouldn't be quite that emphasized. It should be a little bit smaller. There we go. So now we have a little bit more realism here. Alright. And now we have another problem. Because we also lost all of the wonderful lines that get action up here. And of course, definitely get those back. If we want.
so now we got that. So now we need the tip of that ear.
Right over here. That still has to be a harsh line, so we're just gonna ignore that pencil because honestly, it's not really gonna matter. Alright, and we're gonna carry it in with some of that yellow ochre. Okay, now here's the thing. The color in this ear is actually pretty creamy. There's not a lot of color to it. There's a lot of gray tone to it, but not a lot of color. Clearly, you need to have the color in order to translate depth, make it more vibrant. So we're going to regulate the color to the outside, like so, and then we're going to pull it in. Now down here, the base of that ear is a pretty creamy chestnut yellow, a lot of highlight in it. It's clearly a deeper color than the rest of the ear, and is attached to this base down here. So we're going to soften that edge just a little bit, and we're going to let it dry like that and see what happens. Then we have to pull this down here. Okay, this is again part of that ear, so we need to translate this color and that color. So we're going to need a marriage of the two. So now that elk has an ear, and that ear looks like it actually belongs to that elk. Alright, now back in with the center of that ear, which thankfully, I've not gotten too wet. Alright. So, we can go back in with our umber. And we're going to go in with the combination of the two blues so that it really truly gets translated as black. Alright, so we want it to be a real strong color. I do want to get in with this finer brush though. Got a little bit of black tipping over here, which kind of carries the fur in, and a little bit of depth over here. Okay, I still want to have, I know that this is still a really fairly light color, but I still want to get a little bit more that umber and the sienna and carry that up here just a little bit. There's just too much of jump there. Grab some of the yellow. There's just too much of a jump here for my eye to really like it. So that is one ear. Same thing with the other ear. Got a really dark line here. Dark line here. And then around the bend. And then inside is a bunch of really creamy colors. We still have to emphasize that black edge, which isn't really truly black. It does have a lot of shadow in it. Just going to translate to your eyes being black. And then we need to make a little bit of a distance jump here, so. We need a little bit more shadow on this back ear than we need on the front ear. And then we can go in with this yellow ochre and bring it down. We just dragged a bunch of color in there. It's a little too dark. Not an issue, we can bring it out. No. Here's the thing, I'm looking at my reference picture. This is a lot darker than this is right here. And I'm not gonna get this any lighter. I'm not gonna get that without destroying the paper. So I'm gonna go in here with a little bit of blue. Just give that a little bit more shadow. I know that does mean I may have to darken this one. And actually, truth, now I'm going ear to ear. Yeah, we're gonna go in with a little blue here. And give this a little bit of depth. Okay. This is a little bit more realistic. Lift that up. Okay. So we got a little bit more realism here. Alright, so now onto this rack. The rack. Every trophy hunter's dream. Alright, so this is a lot of umbers and siennas. But we got a lot of shadow, so let's really go with what we know about the shadow and focus on that. So we got a lot of shadow here. The shadow line here, the line of action, comes down this way. And there's a heavy set here. And then this kind of goes up like this and creates spires. There's definitely a heavier edge here. Wind up with too much water, we can always lift it out. Oops. That's a lot of water. And I almost lifted everything out. Yay! I lifted everything out. That's not what I wanted to do at all. Alright, so then we got this here, and this has got a lot of darkness in it, and our lines here really do a fantastic job of anchoring that ear. You know, a little bit sienna in there. And so we got a lot of color in here. Just really gonna glue it down. Oops. All right. So I'll keep working with it a little bit while it's wet, because that will help define whatever texture we have to put on here. have a feeling right now this just looks a little bit comic booky, but honestly, that's pretty okay right now, because it is. Whoops! That would have probably helped if I widened out that angle. Here we go. Alright, there we go. And from this, we're going to get just a little bit red with that sienna. Okay, so now those lines of, those texture lines that we'd worked on in the 2D, really going to help to carry this over here. And the color is going to help to translate some distance, because down at the head, it's a lot of very cool colors. So now that we're into these colors back here, we can get into yet another color. This is going to have to help tie in our fall background. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, I hate to tell you, this was actually a fall piece, but because of my full-time job that I need to pay bills, I was not able to get done in a timely manner. Alright, so now we're going to bring in this yellow ochre. Again with the yellow ochre? Yep, again with the yellow ochre. Your color helps to bring themes into other areas, and in this case, the antlers are really, they're very much off the page, and they're off the page for a reason. Design-wise, they're off the page because I want to emphasize the power and the mass that these antlers have. Dark color here, and it coming out like this. And it really adds an extreme amount of weight to the top of this piece. we're going to thin that out just a little bit.
I don't need the second one
to be quite as dark. I do want it to be the same color, but not quite as dark. Alright. Alright. We can get some of this texture going. And we're going to get into that sienna and yellow mix, but I still have to put a little distance in it. So we're going to cool it down with some of those blues. Again, keeping it warm. Sop up some of this water here. This is a lot too much water. And then pop in the water, that's like a lot. I don't want to see you doing your job wrong, but that's a lot of water. It's like Noah and he had a flood and it was on your painting. So again, I'm keeping this really pretty loose. And here again, we need to make sure that we're delineating the difference between the back rack and the front rack. Two antlers. Oop. Uh-oh, spaghetti-o. All right. So I think at this point we may break. I can cure this paper just a touch. It's a little too wet here. I got a little too much water on it. There we go. Alright. Now this section here is really odd because there's a lot of light shining directly down here. Okay? So what I got to do is I got to come up with a mixture between the yellow and the sienna to kind of marry the two. And then we got to kind of lift it out. So we're going to put it in and we're going to take it off. Like that. That seems like a lot of waste. It could be a lot of waste, but we're not really putting a lot down on the paper. Alright, so here we are with this antler. This little prong here, as it were. Give that one some emphasis. Bring this one back. And then this one drops down into a really pretty warm yellow color. Keep in mind, your colors are going to mirror other colors in your painting. Alright. So now, if we back this out. Alright, now we've got this general concept, and he looks like an elf. And I haven't put in his heavy, heavy tree here. And that is because what I did put in next was his background. Actually, what I put in next was his tree, but I really want to put in his background. So, and I kind of freestyle that in, so we'll do that same thing again. And all it really did was give his persona an anchor point. Honest and truly, this year I'm less concerned with than I am with what is going to be going on in the rest of this. So we're just going to kind of add some general outline here, because I'm not This area here, not my big concern. Okay. So my other concern was with this piece is that I really wanted to do some really bright fall colors through here that were kind of reminiscent of his coat. So a lot of bright yellows and oranges. So we're going to go in with that cad yellow. The really, really bright, bright colors. And that cad red light, which is actually most people would think of it as orange. Okay. And kind of get a mix of the two. Alright, so then where do I want to put that? I'm going to put that over here. Notice how that's starting to buckle like that. So it's starting to buckle because I didn't really pre-treat this paper at all. On the black and white version, I didn't do too much background detail at all, and I'm still not going to, but I am going to cover the background more, and I'm covering the background more because it's not going to interfere with the rest of the texture or the storytelling of that's going on. Now, if you haven't picked it up already, yes, in fact, I am using diluted versions of the same colors that are in his coat. And that ties his natural coloring into his environment. Now, if I take just a little bit of red, this would be the crimson red, and we add it to his natural coat color, we're going to get that much brighter red. Some more accent behind him. I'm still keeping it really loose, because honestly, this is a practice piece. It's not like I'm going to be putting this up for sale or anything. Right on. There you go. Alright. Alright. And then with a little bit of that yellow ochre, for a bit more of that. Now we're getting that pop of color here and there and everywhere. And now, these dark tones here don't look quite so awful. Because now you have something to compare them to. I kind of want to carry that red through here a little bit. Also because it'll make the rough stand up. So in doing this, I'm kind of helping myself later when I'm going to do the acrylic piece. Kind of figure out how I want to do the color balance. Sleeve on that, didn't I? Nope. Alright, so with some accent color. I really need to let this paper rest because it's buckling all over. Have a kind of concept of where that's going. And then we kind of had that blue sky behind him. Now, do I want to put blue in here? I could or I couldn't. I found that blue sky when I shot it was, with all of this, it's going to really draw your eye over here. So layout-wise, I really don't want to do that. However, it could get really monotonous continuing on with this yellow theme we've kind of got going on, where I'm kind of blanketing everything in yellow. I think for right now, I'm just going to kind of leave this. You kind of have an idea of what I'm doing here. And where this is going to go with the next piece. So now, the next episode, we're going to kind of combine the two disciplines between the color balancing and texture. And then I'll put in a few little tricks, because I also, one more thing I want to do that I thought would be kind of fun is to kind of bring in a couple of leaves from the background to be, you know, laying here. Or falling. So I'm just doing kind of an impression so I remind myself that's kind of where I wanted to go with this. And I think I want to do the next piece much larger, so that I can actually have some more fun with it. Because right now, I mean, I can make these little notations down here that's kind of where I wanted to go. But I can't do much with it as far as really getting in depth with it. At least I don't want to. So that's where this guy stands. So I hope you'll stick around for the next installment. The next installment, we're going to bring the elements of this painting together. Along with this one. And we're going to see how this, it's the marriage of the two goes. I'm sure I will not be doing it in a 9x12 format, though, so. Check you later.